Random House Audio presents Why You're Not Married Yet, the straight talk you need to get the relationship you deserve. Written and read by Tracy McMillan. Introduction. All through your 20s, you were fine. Working, shopping, getting drunk on the weekends, and having sex with your boyfriend or whomever, not necessarily in that order. Then something happened. Another birthday, maybe, a breakup, your best friend's wedding. Suddenly, there you were, walking down the aisle wearing something halfway decent from J. Crew that you would totally be able to repurpose with a cute pair of boots and a jean jacket. And as you made your way toward the altar, looking at a groom who wasn't yours, not that you'd even want that particular groom, you found yourself, for the first time ever, having something, feelings, about the craziest thing. Why you're not married. Why you're not even close. Intellectually, you know there's nothing wrong with not being married. But then, why does it kind of feel like there is? As if the life train is getting ready to pull out of the station and somehow you're stuck trying to buy a ticket at a malfunctioning kiosk. You keep swiping your credit card, but nothing happens. You're starting to wonder if this is like Europe, where your card needs to be embedded with some sort of magical chip to work. The whole purpose of this book is to help you do something that, if you're like a lot of women I know, might pain you to even admit that you want to do. And that something is, get married. But let's get one thing clear right away. This is not a book about finding a man. In fact, it's hardly about men at all. Because getting married, as you've probably figured out by now, is not about finding a man. There are zillions of guys out there. The question is, how come you're not marrying any of them? This is a book about you, about what kind of woman you are, specifically whether you are the kind of woman who is ready for marriage, and if you're not, how you can be. Naturally, you probably think you already are that woman. Who wouldn't think that? But one of the ideas behind this book is that you could probably stand to take a good, honest look at where you are. Okay, a gooder, honester look. To really assess what your negative traits might be and how they might be holding you back. It's unlikely that you're doing every single thing wrong, but it's also unlikely that you're doing everything right. Only by being willing to really search your soul and look with compassion upon whatever you find there will you expand as a person, and as a result become ready or more ready for marriage. The premise here is that marriage is about love. Not the kind of love where you feel like you're starring in a really amazing Banana Republic commercial. The kind where you take a risk, put your ego aside, let down your defenses, and decide to love a man for who he is, not what you want from him. Even if what you want from him is to love him. And of course, marriage and a baby. It's as simple as this. If you're not married and you want to be, you need to express more love, not get more love. Express it, feel it, be it, see it everywhere. Like Madonna said, and I know this is cheesy, it's about opening your heart. Gold rings and handguns. So who am I and why should you listen to me? Well, first off, I'm not the kind of expert who did everything right in relationships and is now going to pass along some golden tablets with the get married info on them. On the contrary, I am a formerly royal mess when it comes to relationships, but I've worked my ass off to have a healing, kind of a girl version of Robert Downey Jr. if men were crack and gold rings were handguns, who finally hit rock bottom. For the past 10 years or so, I've been a sort of combination lay therapist, love coach, and mating, not dating, sponsor. My practice, quote-unquote, takes place at the water cooler, in the cafeteria, at the coffee house, or in the ladies' room, usually when I'm supposed to be doing my real job. I'm a television and film writer, and before that, I wrote broadcast news for 15 years. Not that I ever went out seeking clients. It's more like I delved into all sorts of different subject matter as a way of evolving myself. I totally needed evolving. And invariably, I would find myself passing along what I had learned, mixed with my insights about people and my experiences in relationships. As the years went by, almost to my surprise, I started helping people. I'll never forget the time I was walking through a big mall in Beverly Hills and I ran into a girl I was acquainted with. She excitedly stopped me and told me that she'd taken something from a really nice chance conversation we'd had at a coffee shop 2 years earlier, and now she was living with a great guy whom she loved. How cool! I was really happy for her and glad to know that I had contributed something to the planet in some small way. The gist of that coffee shop conversation became what is now Chapter 9. That was the first of many such encounters. Since then, I've helped numerous women get on the road to marriage, usually not because I showed them how to get a guy, but because I helped them shift their perspective about being a woman. That changed how they thought about themselves and moved through the world, and the next thing you know, they were walking down the aisle. I'm also the mother of a teenage boy. I've said in the past, and I'll say it again, that 14-year-old boys are like the single-cell protozoan version of a husband. I often want to invite my single girlfriends over to my house for a day so they can get a clear picture of what they're really dealing with when it comes to men. It's not that all men are immature. It's that all men have a part inside them that matches the part inside me that never really left ninth grade. And in order to love them and love myself, I'm going to need to get realistic about that part. Then there's the other big thing about me. I've been married and divorced 3 times. Yes, 3. Once each in the 1980s, 1990s, and 2000s. Somehow, I also managed to squeeze in 3 live-in boyfriends and 4 less significant others, plus pine after scores of unavailable men who wouldn't or couldn't love me. I was a busy gal. In my decades of dating and marrying, I have screwed up so many right relationships and chased after so many wrong ones that I've learned a lot about what works and what doesn't. Now I'm like a jailhouse lawyer who's done so much work on her own case that I can help you with yours. I know what you're doing wrong because I've done it. And I'm the first to admit that I've got a pretty dubious track record when it comes to staying married. Getting married, however, that is a different story. Don't ask me why, but attracting guys who are willing to marry me, or are at least willing to cohabit, is like my main superpower. Talking a lot is a very close second. I've thought about this quite a bit, and I've come to the conclusion that while I am sweet and faithful, and a man can be sure he will never, ever be bored with me, there's nothing particularly special about me. There are girls out there who are way more marriageable than me, but who haven't seen a third of my action. I think my success in this area is more about my readiness to move toward and choose men who are willing to make commitments, as well as, and this is super important and often more difficult, the willingness to let go of the men who aren't. I don't take full credit for this. A big part has to do with the fact that I grew up in foster homes. I entered the world of dating with one objective, to avoid men who would abandon me. If we were talking about presidents of the United States, I was all about gentle, thoughtful, lusting only in his heart Jimmy Carter. The Bill Clintons of the world could go blow their saxes in some other chick's bed. In my mind, the only thing worse than dating a guy like that would be marrying him. And I was all about getting married. Let me stop right here. I bet you're wondering how I ended up walking down the aisle multiple times before plucking out a single gray hair. A lot of people assume I married bad men and or am bitter about marriage as a result of my 3 divorces. Neither is the case. Here's a quick rundown. Husband number 1. The second guy I ever slept with, a guy I started dating at age 17, to his credit I lied, he thought I was 19, and wedded, on a boat, after a very reasonable 2-year courtship. He was 10 years older, with an MBA, and a great job at a Fortune 500 company, where he still works, BTW, 28 years later. In other words, an honest-to-goodness great guy from a great family. The only problem was me. I was just too young to make and keep that kind of commitment. Husband number 2. 13 years later, along came Dan, a very nice minister's son I met at work. 6 months into our relationship, at age 31, I found myself pregnant. Wanting desperately to have the kind of family I dreamed of as a child, I knew what to do. Commit. But I had no idea how to do it. Unable to surmount a lifetime of abandonment programming, after 3 years of marriage, I just did what came naturally. I left. Okay, I only moved 3 miles away, but still. I simply could not tolerate the kind of closeness that comes with marriage to a stable, loving man. This isn't an excuse. It's simply a fact. Dan and I are now candidates for the Co-Parenting Hall of Fame, or we would be, if there was one. Husband number 3. Last but not least, there was Paul, whom I married at 40 and divorced at 41.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.